Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome to the Plastic Empire Podcast. I'm Bill Singh.
I'm Alan Kaplan.
And this is Pedro Rodriguez coming to you live from Plastic in the Attic, Brooklyn, with everybody, with the boys from the Plastic in the Attic, with a very special guest. We have Chris Sterett, who helped give a huge start and is our resident expert on third-party transformers. Okay, we're going to discuss today the history of third-party. We're going to discuss the ins and outs of third-party. We're going to look at his collection because he gave me a quick look around, and it's amazing. Okay, so basically this is anybody that has – anybody that'd like to get in contact? And Bill, where can they get in contact with us?
They can get with us on Skype, TPE, at theplasticempire.com. If you have any questions that you want us to ask Chris or anything you want to know, TPE at theplasticempire.com, and that's our Skype. I have it up now, so feel free to send us some messages.
Absolutely. Any questions you have, but I know I'm going to have a lot of questions. I'm really interested in what Chris has to say. So, Chris, how are you?
Hi, everybody. Love and peace to everybody. Thank you for having me on the show. It's an honor and a privilege.
It's an honor for us, man.
It's actually for us. So, Chris, why should we care about what you being on today?
Honestly, it didn't seem like anyone did care about the ins and outs of third parties throughout the years. They just cared about basically what we all cared about, what was going to be coming out next. I find it interesting that recently, especially on a few Facebook pages, that people are really interested in knowing, like, what it costs, what's the process. I'm sorry, there seems to be a semi-truck going by or something.
Oh, that's Alan. Don't worry about it.
No, this time that's not me.
Oh, okay. All right, well.
Last night, Alan had the Hell's Angels running.
Parked right outside his window and taking off from
his apartment.
Yeah,
oh,
Alan.
That's fun.
I think Alan lives above a tattoo parlor or something like that.
Right outside a tattoo. One of the world's most famous tattoo parlors in the country, apparently, Spider Murphy.
Hey, where's all his neck tattoos and the giant crown right here?
No, he only does trans stamps.
Every day I'm thinking of going in there, every day.
Well, they got to give you a deal, because if they don't, you just be like, all right, I'm going to put on my Doc Martens with the heaviest, like, you know, steel toe boot, and I'm going to walk around like a Bigfoot up in this thing. It's all you fall off. Free tattoo.
That's awesome. All right. Well, we'll talk about what tattoos we should get on Alan later. There's a nice canvas. There's a nice white canvas there to work on.
Very nice.
But look, here at Plastic at the Plastic Empire, we love our toys. We love our pop culture, and we love to know how they come about. I know a lot of people out there love to complain about the prices of things. Oh, these third-party toys are killing me. They're too expensive. They complain about the merchandise that's made by actual first-party companies. That I always say that collecting
that's
is
legit.
And I got to say that collecting is a privilege, not a right. But it would be interesting, and it does help clear the air. Why is it that things cost the way they do?
Okay, first and foremost, everybody knows the obvious reason, because we're not making 50,000 of something. I mean, you know, whatever Hashtag makes something, it's 50, 80,000, maybe even 150,000 units. When we're making something, literally, Fans Toys, Fans, any company, nobody makes more than 2,000 in a run. It's not, I mean, the most I've ever heard of a run getting made was 5,000 units. And yeah, there's a potential, if you do well, to have a second and a third run. But it's highly unlikely, especially in these days where everything seems to be so saturated. You've got Hasbro found out that they couldn't beat third parties with legal matters, so they decided to attack third parties with fire with fire. They were like, okay, how much are people spending on third parties every month? Okay, let's make a new generations line that's along a collector's line that that a lot of third-party collectors will say, oh, this Springer's good enough for me. Forget about Warbot Defender. I'm going to get this generation Springer. And then they figured with the if we release a new MP every other month, that would take care of the rest of their of the people's expendable income, because they'll choose our MPs because you could get two or three of our MPs for the price of one of the third party MPs.
Wow.
Once again, because they're making 50 to 80,000 or whatever, and we're making 2,000.
Oh, that
and their that makes stuff sense. Is free. Their stuff is free to them. For us to make the most simple cast on Earth, that's $5,000. Normally a cast is like $20,000. For them, they have all the materials. A cast will cost them $10. The plastic they make themselves. Like, they can make if they were to make one of our products, they can make it for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah.
But they would have to make 50,000. But even if they didn't, it would still be pennies on the dollar because they already have everything.
But unfortunately, we don't get the quality that you guys put into it. That's one of the reasons why you'd be surprised. Some people don't understand about quantity and the fact that these things are being made over the Pacific Ocean, mm-hmm. on the other side of the Pacific Ocean. All right, so that definitely adds to the price. But I'm one of those people, if I have the disposable income, I am willing to pay extra to get something that is great quality. Like one of my recent, I absolutely love this hound. Okay? This Make Toys, Make Toys, you guys tell me. All right, this right here is just gorgeous. Hey, there you go. You got the tune version. I mean, this is just precious. I love it. I gotta go with the chrome. I gotta go with the chrome and the original toy.
Oh, I'm mad at you. I'm a chrome slut.
I think we're all chrome sluts over here.
Yes.
Now, how did you get involved with this whole third party side of the game?
It was so early in the beginning that whenever Keith, my buddy, not Mr. X, no, there's well, not Keith.
Well,
call my buddy Wong.
Okay, Chris, just to interrupt you, since I'm not some of the audience members, and especially me, we don't know who these names are that are and where they come from. If you could just give me if you could just quickly tell me, Keith from Voltron. So we can have some kind of that?
I don't want him to get confused with Keith X, because Keith X is the one that owns like every third party known to man, like Unique Toys, DX9.
Okay, wait a minute. You gotta stop right there. Stop. You gotta stop right there. You got to stop right there, because that's awesome. Okay. Yeah, we don't know that. So I don't know that. That is amazing. So you're telling me that there is somebody who is the architect, or not the architect, but is the overboss of particular companies?
The puppet.
Okay, who is the puppet master?
I like the architect. I love the Matrix. it's just like GM Motors, though. You have a bunch of companies. That way, if one of them screws up and makes you look bad, you've got all these other companies that you can fall back on.
Oh, I love the analogy.
Everybody does it. Fans. After doing that thing and you guys inviting me, the manager of Fans Project contacted me, and they are the most secretive of all the third parties. And he was like, dude, when you go on these podcasts, please. He like gave me a free diesel when I didn't even know him back in the days, like months before
nice.
I came out. Like they would always give me gifts for helping them.
And Diesel was the Fans Project Motormaster
for
their first Menosaur.
Yeah,
third party
yeah.
Minotaur.
The one that is really hard to transform if you're like me, dude.
You aren't the only one. There's a lot of... It's a little different. It's different from the G from its original one. So there's a lot more going on, a lot more weapons. Yeah, it's work. Very cool, but it's a lot of work to get it transformed.
I think the designer is a genius. I just think I can't fathom his genius, and that's why it was. I got it done in a half hour, so it didn't take too long. But like the hips. Oh my God.
It is. So we're not gonna divulge. We don't, and I'm not gonna ask you, and don't need to divulge any Fans Project. But Fans Project, is that it? Are they? Do they have any other subsubsidiaries?
Yeah.
Who are they?
And I don't. I can't.
Is that top secret?
I can't say. I'll tell you everything about the other guys because they don't care anymore. But FP. They don't want, especially because, like, there's big stuff happening, like, how can I say it without giving anything away? With one of their lower companies, they're really trying to go legit in a way.
Gotcha.
And so, like, they want to keep all that really DL so they could keep it, so it can happen.
Okay. Because
you know how, like, that sticker company just recently got picked up by Haztech?
No, which one, Ennis or the Ocean? Which one?
Yeah, I think it was Ocean. They were like a third-party company that Hasbro was like, we'll take you guys. And that was like, Hasbro, don't get mad at me, please, but because they're always listening, they. but like
this is bugged as we speak.
Oh, wait a minute, Chris, can you give me 1 second? I forgot to
I forgot.
Any comments or statements made by Chris on this program do not reflect the values or the opinions of the Plastic Empire.
Jesus.
Continue.
We just got real corporate real fast.
We got copyrighted right there.
No, I deserve it because I sometimes obviously say things I shouldn't say, and I go too far with the secrets and stuff. But And then when you're talking about Hasbro, you're talking about official company. I'm sure you guys are going to start talking about KOs, and then we're going to have some real legal ground.
Anyway, we'll talk later.
Okay.
Oversized generations. Okay. But anyway.
Wow, where'd you pull those out of?
It literally just arrived.
Just out of his ass.
Yes.
But I'm sorry to interrupt, Chris. Okay, so I love Fans Project. So you know what? We can move. We'll talk about the stuff that's good. We won't get them. We can move on. But let me know about the other groups. I mean, who is this guy, Keith X?
I noticed that you found that interesting. Like, before me and my brother left, there was only four people running the third parties. All of the third parties.
All of them.
All of them. And that also brings up another thing. You were talking about price. Well, I gave you, like, the number one reason for price, you know, the quantity and cost. They have all the materials. But you guys got to know that we have a middleman in our third-party world. And a lot of our third-party products that we like a lot,
yeah,
we're getting 15...
Leo Kaiser.
$15 to $30 added onto the price because this middleman bullies everybody. And he's done it to us. Like, we didn't let him. But he, when you make a pro, if you're a new third party, he'll come to you and he'll say, sell me your entire run or I won't carry your product. And he's the major distributor for Asia. You know, you guys are going to figure out who he is soon
enough.
Okay,
I have a question. This major distributor, is that where the American-based and Canadian-based, I guess, online companies get it from?
Yeah, they get it through him.
Chris, this is a question from me.
Yeah.
So, something I've always wondered, I talk to Pedro about this all the time. You know, Big Bad Toy Store carries a lot of third-party products. However, there is some product they do not carry that's on TF Source, or they don't carry that's on another site. Why do some sites get this product but some do not?
because man, is there drama and behind the scenes in the third party world. If you'll notice, Robot Kingdom doesn't carry Fans Project, Make Toys, or MMC. You know, and
wow,
there's a reason.
Those are three big boys.
And for my friends in Australia, like Craig Andrews and stuff, they used to buy all their Fans Project stuff from Robot Kingdom, but now they have nowhere to grab their stuff, or they have to pay way more shipping because they tried to, you know, like, they couldn't agree on it's that whole, like, marking up and wanting to be the middleman. Like, I've got money, I'm going to buy all your product, and I will sell them to everybody else. But say I paid $10 for my product, and I want to make $15. I want to get $5 in profit. So I give it to all the stores for $15, no matter where they are. They have to pay the shipping, right?
Yeah.
But he wants to take it at $15 and sell it to the other stores for $25 or $30. So now my product is not doing as well. My product is $48, you know, whenever it should be $32, you know, and it would be selling a lot better. So it's not a really nice thing to do. It really sucks because we're talking not just one company is affected. Every company
who wants to play ball
has got to go through him. And I mean, I guess I'm not a businessman. Please know that. I was never able to make money off of people. I couldn't sell Transformers. I tried it. I just can't make money off of anybody, much less friends.
Well, you can't make it because you're not. You can't make it because you can't. You're not good at business, or you have too much of a soul.
I will not charge a penny more than I pay.
Nice.
I guess it's soul, but I just can't do it. And especially whenever, whenever I was buying everything wholesale, I was pissed because I would have to buy product made by us through him at an upper price. I couldn't even get my own I mean, I'm not a designer, but, you know, we would give all these designers to third parties, and we would pay for everything and make it, but he would make me pay extra from what I should be able to just take it off the factory, right off the conveyor belt, pay the factory the price, and it's fine. But no, man, he is a serious business guy.
How did this guy get into this position? For as much as you can say, I mean.
Basically, he's in Hong Kong, so he gets the a lot of the third parties back in my days. At the end of the workday, they would all meet. I know it sounds crazy, but you'd
like
have
no, it doesn't sound crazy at all. We have mafia here in New York, so it sounds like
mafia to me.
Yeah, no, really, no. You'd have TFC, you'd have Dr. Wu, you'd have Steven from Robot Kingdom, you'd have, of course, all of the unique toys guy there, and you'd have all these different guys. And to be honest,
iGear.
iGear's in Singapore. If you guys want to get into, like, the legal aspects of what Hasbro went after, I could tell you the exact three people.
I'm already three stories behind. We are going to talk about that, but it's like sensory overload. This is awesome.
This is all right,
Let's go back to please. Let's go back to the cabal, and then the legal stuff is something I'm definitely interested in.
Okay, now, and that's another thing. Like, the guy who owns KFC, X-Transbots, Unique Toys, I mean, and I can't even say with confirmation, but basically all those weird companies like SXS, all those are probably him too. I mean, because like I said, there's only four of us. You got the Fans Project guys, you know, the Fans Project. I almost want to call them the Canadian team, you know, MMC, Make Toys, Fans Project, but
I
don't know.
Yeah, I hadn't heard about that.
That's giving away too much.
No, I've heard that. No, that's been online for a long time.
Okay, good.
I never understood it, how you could, because in Canada, Hasbro actually should have a reach in Canada, but that's been online for a long time that there was something Canadian about them.
Oh, they have a reach in Canada. Remember we were talking about the customizer? They got kicked out of Canada for customizing?
A big customizer in the Transformers community, Incline Designs. Tell them what happened.
Dude, literally, he got a month's notice from the government of Canada that he had to get out of Canada for customizing Transformers.
What?
Dead serious. Now, if you get into the actual details, it has to do with taking an official product, changing it, and then selling it.
Selling it is always there.
That happens on Facebook all the time. I mean, how does this, what made this particular case
go? It's a lot more difficult on Facebook. They have to somehow become your friend. On eBay, it is open to the public. I have seen his stuff. Rumble Frenzy, Frenzy Rumble or whatever his name is, he was one of the first guys to do that.
I remember that, yeah.
Frenzy Rumble and Incline were the two biggest, best customizers for years. They were the most well-known. I don't want to say best because that would be an opinion, but they were definitely the echelon elite. And I'm not saying anything bad about Incline. The reason why I'm bringing up this story is I think nothing is more gangster than getting kicked out of a country for customizing Transformers. Fucking awesome. And then he goes there to teach a class like 2 years later, and they literally have him on a list of, nope, you can't come into Canada. And they didn't let him come in. That's OG. That's really impressive, man.
Okay, so what we're seeing is that there seems to be a million or maybe a few thousand different third party companies, and every once in a while a new one crops up. You know, Bad Cube, like you said, SSX. These XT9, the ones that just made the Combiner Wars Ultra Magnus upgrade armor. If I have the box.
Yes, I know what you're talking about. That looks like a nice kit too.
Oh, it's an awesome kit. I can get
it. What this guy does is he goes to a lot of the designers come from us, the Western Hemisphere, Europe and America, and what he does is, which is just the opposite of what we did, is you're a designer, say. He comes up and says, I'll give you $1,000 for your design. And then you say, but I want my own third party. He'll say, no. He'll say, I'll give you $1,000 for your design. If you want it made, that's how it's going to go down. And you say, okay, so you sell your idea. You don't get to say anything about it. And guess what? If he wants to, if he has a product coming out that's the same thing, and he wants yours to do bad, he can make your product crummy to ensure that his comes out good. Now we've seen it happen with the particular yellow figure that everybody was waiting for that had a very good design, but it came out in not very good quality from what I hear, and I know that this guy plans on making his own, so it's kind of fishy because when it gets made from the factory that we are making our stuff in, the only excuse for having poor quality is a bad assembly team or a rushed mold process, and that means you don't care.
Wow. Okay.
So sabotage.
It's damn. I wish we had the rights to put on the Beastie Boys right now.
I'm hearing it.
That is crazy. So on top of that, a lot of some quality issues might be because of beef.
Beef, exactly. But never with us. Like, even if we had a competing product, the exact same product, the same gun, we would do the best, just as good. Dr. Wu himself, on his lunch break, would go to the factory and make sure that the factory was making your product right.
Yeah, I've never had an issue with any Dr. Wu product. Those swords are immaculate.
He goes himself to the factory, and he watches it being done. And like I said in that messages, at Fans Project were the geniuses that figured out why is good product turning out loose and crummy. They found out it's the assembly team. The product is perfect. but the assembly team is putting it together. They don't know what they're doing. The stuff is too complex. So Fans Project said, you are really good at making complex stuff. Do you want to make some extra money in your off time? And they would hand-pick an assembly team of really good assemblers.
Wow.
And then you've got superior product. And everybody else copied them.
Wow.
Everybody that was smart. If you get a crummy product, it's because they're letting a normal assembly team do it.
Well, I'm thinking about one, and I don't mean to call it out, but it was really bad, and it was really disappointing. I forgot the name of it, but there was a microcassette Soundwave that came out 2009?
Sonicron.
Oh, that piece of crap one?
Yes, when I got it at home, I was just like, what is this?
Yeah. It was floppier than a disc.
Hey, that was... let me think. What could I say? That was somebody's first attempt at a third party that owns a store in Asia, in Hong Kong specifically.
Oh, well. It was... I still have it, but it's kind of tucked away, and unfortunately I can't sell it. But you know what? At this point...
The submarine mode was the best ever.
Yes. Well, at this point, I think we should... I think we're putting the cart before the horse. Chris, tell me, what was your involvement with Dr. Wu? What was the climate when you guys started? What is it that us in the West were able to provide... those in Asia to create this thriving and just insane, and I can't imagine what dollar amount, but Hasbro's got to figure it out, and they're absolutely reacting to it. So tell me about what are your origins? What are the origins of Dr. Wu? What are the origins of your involvement with them and with the climate? I'm repeating myself. I'm sorry.
No, thank you for keeping me on track. We'll go with the first one just to get that out of the way. Like, I'm just a normal fan like everybody else, right? And I see the Dr. Wu, the first product, the little shark clones that I showed in that picture.
Yes.
I could grab one in a second. And when I saw that they were being made, I contacted the guy that was advertising them. And I was like, dude, like, anything I could do to help with, you know, get these off the ground, let me know, because I really want them. I really wanted shark. You know, this is in the beginning of third party, so the idea of getting a shark to con was, like, you never thought it would happen, and I was really stoked about it.
And depending on the Transformers you were playing with, they were pretty good scale.
Right, exactly.
Particularly the Chug line. You know, those.
That's basically all we had at the time. You know what I mean? And it turned out that he was the guy that was making them in the factory for Dr. Wu. And he met Dr. Wu on the train.
Wait, who is he? I'm sorry, I'm a little bit lost.
This is my buddy Keith. Not okay. Keith X, but
not
my
Keith
brother
X.
Keith.
Okay.
And he met Dr. Wu on the train, and Dr. Wu was just making a Transformer head. He was sculpting it, you know, like shaving it and making it. They started talking, and he said, look, you don't have to do anything. I'll produce them for you. We'll put your name on it and all that. And Dr. Wu reluctantly said yes. We made the resin shark clones, and nobody would take them. No store would sell them because they were too fragile. Let me grab them just so I can show.
Yes, go right ahead. This podcast has been brought to you by Big Boy Collectibles. Please go to BigBoyCollectibles.com for all your G.I. Joe needs. When we're back.
good improv.
Sorry about that, guys. Okay.
No problem.
I've broken every one of the ones that I've ever had.
Oh my gosh.
I remember these.
They're super tiny.
How much? Give it to me.
the cool thing is we put two in a package, and the package actually transformed into a Sharktacon.
I never saw that.
See the legs and the arms right here? You cut them out, and they pop out, and then he's got his tail on the bottom.
That's awesome.
So that is very cool.
And just to get 1,000 of these boxes with no insert was $800.
Wow.
$800 just for 1,000 of these.
I believe that.
I'm in. Yeah. I'll give you my address. How much?
Now it's a little. It's a little late now.
Ah, that's
this. What I ended up doing is we have the Vegas Transformer Club here in Vegas, and then in LA they got the LA Collective with Curaman in them, and they have about 100 plus members. We've got like 30 or 40, and so I just sold them all to the people in our groups. You know, this was back in 09.
Three plus six. 9 years too late. Oh, no, wait a minute. I can't count.
Seven.
Seven.
Thank you. That's it.
Jesus. Yeah.
Okay, so...
I thought I was the one.
No, we share that. Or it might be rubbing off. I don't know. One or the other.
Of so, you or so, me.
There you go. That's it. That's what we got to figure out. Hey, Chris. So now that you... Now that you and your buddy, what did you guys do? What did you do? How did you? I understand that you made resin. So how did you get to that point that you had resin copies, that you had something to show Dr. Wu?
Well, he made the resin copies. Then we just took them to the factory. At the time, there were three factories that you could use to make transformers. One was the factory that.
Okay.
And then the other one was the one that was like, back in the days, KO Toys was owned by Mike, and that's whenever you had the actual website and everything would come in.
Yes, I remember
pieces,
that. That's
where he made his stuff. And then the third place was actually a good place for diecast, and they could make Transformers, but it was like early Impossible Toy quality. Do you remember the RC they made?
Yeah, I have it. Yeah.
Nothing connected. It looked good, but nothing connected. It was...
Yeah.
That was from... But still, companies like, you know, Fans Toys, that die-cast factory makes the best die-cast.
The Fans Toys die-cast is amazing.
Yeah. It doesn't corrode or nothing. So... And then your second question was... the second one was what?
Well, you got the first one, which was you got part of the first one. Actually, I'm not even done with the first one. Other than the Sharktacons, what else did you help? And your buddy?
Everything else. Yeah. What I did was I sold it to all the stores throughout the world. And you know what was really interesting that I found? It never happened with Dr. Wu, but say I was making a product for a friend or something. If that product didn't do well, even if we had like 1,000 of them, even if we had like thousands, like 2,000 or 3,000, all you have to do is sell them to China, and they're gone.
Wow.
You never lose money. All you do, like China, the money, the people, and the wealth is going so high.
Yeah.
And they're middle class that literally, if you wanted to, and like I told you, Dr. Wu makes stuff for G.I. Joe figures, Robotech figures, upgrades for all these other companies, but I don't even know the names of the companies because he sells them all out in China. They buy them up in 24 hours, they're all gone.
Wow.
Remember, that used to be a thing in third parties. Not anymore. You know?
Wow.
Yeah. So.
Wow. So you guys got into. So you guys meet up with Dr. Wu. This is shortly after the big. The big bang, the big start for third party, which was, as we discussed earlier, that Cliff Jumper upgrade set from fans' project, the FP one. That was very, you know, that it was very, I mean, not bootleg, but it was very garage kit-like, all right, before it went really big. How did you guys decide at first they were add-on kits, and then for add-on kits, it moved to figures. Dr. Wu always stayed with the add-on kit, which I imagine was very smart. How did you guys make that decision?
He did make that Dr. Q little cute little T-Rex Grimlock. Okay.
Yes, that is an adorable one. With the big eyes that you can move? Yeah.
He has to stay strictly in the upgrades because, like I said, he's an ER doctor. He works 120 hours a week.
Wow.
Yeah, like, he doesn't have... I mean, he does this as a side thing, you know what I mean? And it's only because he is, like, another designer that we had made in Japan that is such a professional, they can actually make master copies with their bare hands, which is unheard of. You can take this master copy that they made with their bare hands, put it right into a mold, and cast it just how it is. Nobody else can do that. Everybody else, you've got to fine-tune, computer graphic, rearrange, all of that.
You know what? That makes sense. He's a surgeon. He's good with his hands. He's just got to be careful that while he's sculpting, he doesn't cut himself.
Exactly.
And my next question has nothing to do with Transformers, but is wherever he's a doctor, they don't pay them that well, or does he do this strictly because?
You got to understand, in Hong Kong, a 760 square foot place would have your grandparents, your wife, and your kids all in 760 square feet. He wow. has one by himself. He's considered rich.
Oh, I'm glad. Well, I can see why, because the stuff that he makes is great. I loved his upgrade spark plug, right?
Spark plug.
It's funny you say that because the Dr. Wu partners, whenever we made those, we made 200 sets at first, right? Out of 200, Dr. Wu looked at them all. He sent back 170 sets to the factory and said that their eyes are crooked. And the factory was so pissed, they fixed the 170, but they said, we will never, ever make anything that small for you ever again. And then here it is a couple years later, and we've got the little Daniel in the wheelchair, or Chip in the wheelchair, and we've got a few other little Dr. Wu figures.
And I think the last one, I think the last set, right, Alan? The G.I. Joe Transformers crossover. Only human,
only
yes.
Humans. Only human.
I love those.
Those are taller, right? Those are like, I haven't gotten mine in hand yet. No, those are like around 3 feet.
If you'll
notice. No, Alan. Yes, they're tiny. They should be able to, they're into scale, what I think, with Masterpiece.
Yeah, but the
really?
Was way bigger because the factory was like, we'll never make them that small again. So we had to make the Archiville bigger. But as the factory realized that they could do it, they just had to pay attention to the eyes. Now we can make small stuff again.
Now, Chris, that's do you awesome. Think you can get to a point where you can make figures like that but make them articulated? Because the only human figures are just gorgeous, but no articulation.
I agree. Honestly, the only way that you could do that price effectively from the factory is if you did them unpainted in pieces, where the person puts them together and paints them. And even though that's great and all, there's a lot of people who could do it, but like I customize and I couldn't do it on those little things.
Right.
They would look terrible. They would look like my remember those figures you got with Fans Project Assaulter, the Sandstorm?
Yes, they were just like itty-bitty. They were smaller than micro machines, a solid cast of either the figure or the vehicle.
Yep, and if you saw my paintwork on them, you'd be like a third grader did this. It's bad. It's real bad.
Well, a question I want to ask about Dr. Wu is I haven't seen anything from them. I haven't seen anything from Dr. Wu in a while.
Yeah, me neither.
The problem is, what happened was I had my little mental panic disorder breakdown about 2 years ago, and that's why I said I'm good for information from 09 to 14, because I was like, like it was all left up to Keith. And then Keith, who hasn't had a day off from his normal job in over a decade, he's super, super sick in the hospital. And so Dr. Wu doesn't have us, and the only person he could have is Keith X. And
that makes sense.
They don't get along, so like Dr. Wu's been put on hold because I'm not in Hong Kong. Because if you want good quality products, you have to be at the factory.
Yeah.
Even Fans Project will go all over the world and go to the factory, and they will talk to the people there and say, "Look, we're not gonna pay you if you give us crap."
You know, not for nothing. That's what Boss Fight Studios did for the Viturian Hacks line, an articulated 3¾-inch line. They took about, I think, 2 or 3 trips to China, to the factories to walk through. Okay, and it took pictures in the hotel room of the actual product, as it was being prepared, you know, as it came off the conveyor belts. All right, so that makes sense. A lot of people complain, oh, why are they spending our money going to China, you know, taking vacations?
No, we're doing the same thing right now. We're doing Inside Collectibles, and we're forced to send somebody from our production team there because the fact that they're not trusting what they're getting and they're not trusting photos. We need to send somebody to China to actually oversee the shit that's coming out.
If my friend wasn't sick right now, I know he would take care of it for you. I am so sorry that, like, we're incapacitated. Otherwise, I would... I mean, that was something that I loved to do is when someone was getting screwed over, we would go right to the factory and talk to them and figure out, you know, or we would Skype like this so I can look the guy in the eyes, because if you look me in the eyes, you know I'm honest.
Yes.
And so I look him in the eyes to see if he's honest, you know what I mean, and if he's lying to me or whatever. And then, honestly, like, all you have to do is just hire another, it's like a general contractor, really. You just hire another general.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, but Chris, at the same time, I understand that, you know, you guys, you, Keith, you have to take care of what's most important, which is yourself, your health, you know, physically, mentally. So that makes sense.
Yeah.
It really sucked. I felt terrible because I didn't want to leave Keith with all the work, because we also had our company Transformazing Toys, and then we had, you know, our homeboys company, Zenith Forge, who we didn't get to do a whole lot with. We only got to make
Zenith
the one
Forge.
Kit.
What does Zenith Forge? That sounds really familiar. I may even have that.
He's a customizer on the East Coast. He's a real big guy. Everybody likes him. Really nice guy.
And what was that one product that he made? Do you remember?
Well, he did make, remember the Beast Hunters Prime Head? And was it the gun? The Gatling gun? For Beast Hunters Prime?
Oh, Beast Hunters, yes, I do have it. Yes, it came with a gun. It came with the underslung Gatling gun.
Right.
Okay, I was like, I knew
right
I have that.
Pedro, pull it out right now.
Let me tell you something about that. If I may, I just want to tell you a dirty something about that. Okay, the factory told us a price for that product, right? And it was really high. We told the retailers what we wanted to sell it at, right? And we said, if you have to charge more than this, then we don't want you to carry it. Well, not only did the retailers lie to us and charge more, but we found out when we actually got the product that it was going to be $8 cheaper for us. So we told them that it's $8 cheaper for them, of course. And we expected for them to lower the price.
Oh, that's rough. Because you could sell more. You sell more units if it's cheaper price.
You sell more units. Why would you not? I mean,
oh my God!
Not only did they charge more than what we told them MSRP was, but when we gave them $8 off per unit, you know, when you're buying 500, 1,000 units. That's a lot of money, right?
Yeah.
$8? That's $8,000.
Yeah.
So why not pass the savings onto the buyers, the collectors?
Yeah.
I thought
and
that
I'm
was
telling you, and you, they would have sold quicker too, because $8 is a big, it's, you know, if you're like, oh, it's just an upgrade kit, but I'll make it cool. Yeah, I got it for my Beast Hunters Optimus Prime. And I think there was a couple of them. There were two of them. I think I got the metallic edition.
And see, a lot of our American-based companies, they have to charge a lot because of the middleman. Big Bad Toy Store, they don't have a choice. TF Source, he doesn't have a choice on certain third parties. He has to pay what the middleman charges, otherwise he can't carry it.
And that's killer because you need traffic to the store.
You have to carry it. You have to carry it.
Yeah. Yeah, because then people drop you and they'll go with the guy that always has everything.
So there are times where they even sell the stuff for like where they're just getting their money back. Especially Big Bad Toy Store. They'll sell stuff just to get their money back because...
I believe it because I always thought that the Big Bad Toy Store was fair in their prices.
Yeah, I think so too.
A lot of people. Now, people complain no matter what, and everything is too expensive because they have to be able. They want to get their stuff, you know, because it's their right, and they should get it at the price they can afford. But Big Bad Toy Store, there are certain places. Big Bad Toy Store, TFC. I mean, not TFC. TF Source to a certain extent as well. But I'm one person that wherever I could get it cheapest and. Where I can get most things at once, and since, like I told you before, and you know, Alan included, we buy more than just Transformers.
Yeah, and so BBTS has that pile of loot feature. So to Pedro's point, if we're buying G.I. Joe, Transformers, Masters of the Universe, Marvel Legends, it all gets the pile up. We soak up that shipping. We ship one big 75-year-old virgin box, but the shipping is so nice and cheap.
Yeah, and TF Source did the same thing. They had to do the same pile of loot.
No, you're absolutely correct. Like, Joe, does everybody know who the owner of Big Bad is?
Yes, everybody does.
Okay, Joe is one of the nicest people here.
I met Joe. He's great.
Yeah, every time I've ever dealt with him, I have screwed up on invoices, like, every time. And he never yells at me. I love the guy.
He's a nice guy.
Yeah.
And I'm going to tell you, the people at TF Source are really nice as well. That one is a little more mom and pop.
It's mom and pop. Yeah, you got family running that.
Yeah, it's more mom and pop. So, but they do. But they're really nice. They are really nice with that. Mira, ¿qué fue?
Oh, really?
Están en camino.
Yeah.
Oh, look at that Sharticon.
Well, and then you got there's.
I mean, not Sharticon. I'm saying. Oh my God! But it's that's one of the Seacons, but it looks like a Sharticon.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, yeah, you barely got. Oh, I was wondering where my picture went. Now I see myself. I'm sorry. This is my first time on a podcast. I don't know what I'm doing.
Well, this is with Google Hangouts, and it, probably others do it as well. He who speaks gets on the main screen.
Unless you're presenting. If you're presenting, then you're automatically on the main screen.
You don't want my ugly mug on it. Hey,
we've got uglier here. Okay, now, I would love for you to do a nice, slow walk around and show us some of this Transformer goodness that you have here.
Okay, now, you remind me if I've got it in frame.
Okay, and remember, And also, we want to make sure that you are. We can hear you.
Okay.
All right, but don't trip. Don't trip. Don't hurt yourself.
I'll knock everything over.
Exactly. Those Transformers are more important. Those stores are more important than you.
Exactly. Well, that's why I spent so much money on AFA custom cases for my Dioclones because I felt like. Once I'm gone, I owe the next generation to keep them in good shape. That's the gift set, that's the gift set, and then that's the original Diaclone one.
That's the Diaclone gift set?
Yeah, the one that's got the blue Mixmaster and blue Hook with the red chest.
Oh my God. And is that them individually carded?
Yeah, I got those are the first edition Devastator. But they're all complete. I've even got, like, I put the directions and the sticker sheets inside little baseball card holders.
Oh, my God.
Pedro, you and I have, like, these KO versions of those, right?
I didn't buy it. You and Steve Sotano bought it.
Yes. This is the KO. This is the KO set too. It's not the actual gift set. It's the KO set. And then this is just a part swap of a Nemesis Prime with the Year of the Horse Prime.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
And so is that one.
So you got the Nemesis Prime, which is black.
Right.
And then you took the Year of the Horse gold accents that look kind of weird on the black. That is gorgeous.
That's awesome.
Oh, and look at that Optimus Prime flying in the air. How do you have that up? Just like in the original toy adverts, flying in the air. Oh my God, that is awesome.
I was trying to get the what's it called? You know, like whenever in the movie, whenever he did that flying transformation and killed like 12 Decepticons in like 2 seconds.
Yes, like, when he gets off the ship and you got the music.
Yeah. I'm going to take you around in one big run, but I have to let my computer charge. So just real quick, I'll start with like a roundabout. Let's see here.
Okay.
Let's see. There's like.
Well, I want to see that ship wheel. The steering wheel for the ship. That I want to see.
The wind blew it down. My patio outside is all done in nautical theme. I'll show. Right now, battery. I forgot to plug it in, so my battery is.
Yeah. Go right ahead. So you're in the middle of the desert, but you have a nautical theme outside. I love that.
Oh well, hold on a second. I'll show you why. I got the Blue Lagoon out here. See?
Oh, that's gorgeous. Oh, my God. That's just like San Rafael.
Yeah, exactly. only I'm a little bit more ghetto.
It got so windy, though, like all my stuff fell and broke, and so I have to like put it all back up.
I am jealous. I'm surrounded by concrete and my sweaty body because of the humidity. It's not even hot. It's just humid.
We never have to deal with humidity. I love that. I can't take being a desert rat. I can't take humidity.
So Chris, I have a question. I ask this from a professional perspective. I've always been wondering this about third-party product.
Uh huh.
What do you guys do in regard to quality control, safety testing, that kind of thing? That obviously the regular companies have to do. Do you guys do the same thing? Do you skirt it in any way? How is that accomplished with your products?
Right off the bat, almost everything that we ever made, you'll always see like a little warning label, you know, saying like for ages 16 and up.
Yeah.
Because that's one of the things that we take joy in is since it's a third party, we can actually make the stuff sharp. We can make the teeth good enough to start an IV. You know what I mean? Like I like that. Yeah. You know, like the Matrix sword. I was saying how that was one of our biggest money makers.
I love that Matrix sword.
It was die-cast. You could kill somebody. I mean, not that I would promote anything of the sorts, but I mean, that thing is lethal.
You can shank a motherfucker with that.
You can shank a motherfucker with that if you wanted to.
So that covers you with your warnings, but what about, what kind of safety testing do you otherwise, what kind of quality control do you do otherwise?
Well, quality control, that's a definite thing, and that would be something, one, you have a superior assembly team for one. You've got somebody watching over them. And Dr. Wu, for all of our companies, not just his stuff, goes into the factory, especially during the assembly, and he will check. You know, he'll say, okay, this is good. He'll look at the finished product. And like, you know, one guy is doing one thing and the other guy's doing another thing, right? So if he looks at the finished product and the right leg is messed up, he just has to find the guy doing the right legs, go over to him and be like, no, you do it like this. The spring has to go in here and then it'll work.
Are you sure he didn't get shanked by one of those Matrix swords?
My disgruntled employee. No, but honestly, and this is the honest to God truth. I've got video of it. Keith in his office, double and triple checking all of the Made in Japan parts, or all the BNA parts, or Xenu. Like, he's in his office with 1,000 pieces, and he's checking them and reboxing them.
Wow. So no wonder he went crazy. No wonder he's sick.
He works way too much.
Wow. Yeah. Actually, this brings me to the second question. The legality of this. What is, it seems like you know a little bit of the ins and outs, because this is, let's just be upfront about this. All of these are based on hashtag intellectual properties.
Exactly. These,
now, I support it because hashtag does not care that this is what I want at this level, even though I'm willing to spend the money on it.
Right.
How do guys in general get around this stuff? Has anybody been caught? Is it a cat and mouse type of game?
Simple explanation, bro. If you don't mind. I'll just go right into it. Remember when we heard Hasbro's legal team, they're going for it, right? Everybody heard that? There was 3 people they were going after. This is the shocking thing to me. It wasn't like they were going after all third parties. They only saw 3 threats.
Okay.
iGear.
Oh, wow. Okay, that makes sense.
KO Toys, Mike's KO Toys.
Makes sense. Both who disappeared for a while.
Those make sense. But Transformer Galaxy on Facebook.
The guys that took pictures?
That's all they did was took pictures. They never made a dime off of that.
Weren't they from the Philippines or Singapore?
Legally, that's why iGear didn't get in trouble. Because Singapore is like their own world or something. I swear, if you commit a crime and get into Singapore, you're safe.
But you don't want to smoke a doobie in Singapore.
No. Or put your gum or chew gum.
And throw it on the floor?
You can't even chew gum, period.
Whoa.
Yeah. But as far as legality goes, they couldn't do anything to iGear. KO Toys, they stomped like Godzilla stomps a building, dude.
Where was KO Toys based out of?
Mike, KO Toys was out of Hong Kong.
That was a huge, huge company. Unfortunately, I was not able to get the Metro Titan that they had. I had to get mine on eBay, and the chrome came off the face when I got it.
Oh, I got that one too.
But he had that. He had an incredible inventory of classics and G1, and I saw that at first, all the stuff you had to put together, but then for a little bit more, you were able to get it already assembled. But I remember out of nowhere, he just disappeared.
Do you remember during that time, like, they were actually, like, federal, like, shipping agencies were actually seizing giant boxes of KO Toys from him?
No!
Yeah, wow. Like, all over the world, they were showing these giant, and they were all from the KO Toy thing.
So
they destroyed him. Transformer Galaxy, the guy that was running it, he was just taking pictures. So whenever this big corporate, legal team comes in, he got scared he shit his pants. He was like, all I have to do is delete the page, done. And he was like that. But that's the thing, is after that experience, they spent a lot of money, bro, on legal shit, and all they got was KO Toys and a measly Facebook page. That's
Well,
long story short, I'll just save it. Remember how I already explained? They got smart. Hasbro did the smartest thing they could ever do. They calculated what we spent on third parties, the 3 different groups of us. And then they said, if we release a Generations line that were collector's grade and an MP every other month, they won't have the money to buy third parties. Now we see third parties not selling out. We went from Masterpiece 1 to 5 taking 10 years to 5 through 30 taking 5 years.
Yeah.
Six years, you know what I mean?
And they're really quick now with the repaints. Getting as many repaints, you know, immediately. Like, I'm already behind with the black tracks.
See, if anything, Hasbro should be so happy about third parties, because guess what they did? They did a test market that cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, tons of money, and they found a test market. Look, they were looking for the test market when they made MP01. MP01, it's all about hype and advertisement. There was no hyper advertisement. It didn't do well, so they thought the adult collectors were null. We did not exist. Third parties came in and showed them adult collectors will spend $5,000 or more a year on Transformers if you give them what they want. That's why Hasbro was like, oh, you're our test market. Thanks for spending all the money for the test market. We'll take advantage of what you've all the work you did.
Now we know what they want. Wow.
Now we know what they want. And the first one you saw was Blitzwing and Springer. That was the first of their
collection. I gotta tell you, I was griping to Pedro about this over IM. We haven't had a chance to really talk about it, Pedro. You know, you see umpteenth Galvatrons coming out, all these amazing third-party Galvatrons. And so Hasbro's like, okay, the kids want Galvatrons. So they put out Galvatrons.
So let's give you a Headmaster Galvatron.
Holy shit, what a piece of crap with the frickin' Halloween mask. I'm sorry, my God.
I can see, and you're right, but I think the problem now is that as awesome as the Titans Returns line is, that to get something like that from Hasbro, the hollow parts and the lack of paint apps.
It's terrible. All right?
And the hollow parts. And now, it does make sense. It is a lot more affordable to get the Titan Returns Headmasters than it is the make toys Headmasters. Okay,
but you're getting what you pay for. You know, that's what it comes down to. You get what you pay for.
Exactly, because the Coppola, which is
I love that.
Okay, which is the hard case? Is that his name?
Oh yeah.
Okay, the G1 Headmaster. I hated the G1 figure. Their Coppola is one of the best third party figures. That's ever been made, and a functional Headmaster. There he is.
There you go. I mean,
that thing right there, the feet, and just how it transforms, the engineering on these things.
It's amazing.
I put bullet holes, all my chrome domes get beat up.
Oh, I just chrome see that.
Dome. Chrome dome. Chrome dome, thank you.
Gundam markers to it, I blow them up, you know what I mean?
is awesome.
Something about Chrome Dome just says Mad Max to me, his alt form. So
yeah.
I love this guy. It was a great figure.
It's a great figure. Masterpiece. I mean, it is just awesome.
That's the thing. You're going to pay more for a wonderful quality piece like that, what you're getting from Hasbro. And that's the thing, you know, you mentioned paint apps, Pedro. Yeah, you're going to get better paint apps from Takara, but the bottom line is, though, it's the same engineering. They're not gonna fill in
the gaps in the arms and legs and torsos and everywhere. The only thing is the Halloween mask on Galvatron, Alan. I'll say there might be a slight saving grace. First of all, I don't know if you've seen this, Chris. The Hasbro Headmasters have barely any paint apps. Like on the Galvatron, it's got that Megatron.
Okay,
the eyes are just, only the eyes are red. All right, and it's a sloppy job. Okay, but I can imagine that Takara might paint his sides purple to match better. But I'd still rather have the Fan Toys Galvatron that's coming out within the next year.
Oh, I can't wait for that. I can't wait for that.
If I may say, and Hasbro, please don't get mad at me for saying this.
They're gonna come to your house and take all your Transformers away.
Oh, no. You know how they say for my cold, dead hands? That would be me with my Transformers. But look, I've always talked with Hasbro people, right? And if you guys remember...
Wait. Oh, how?
Because you run into them at the factory. They come and they see you. You know what I mean?
Hey, Brett, fancy meeting you here. Oh,
wait a minute. How do they not show up with the authorities gunslinging?
Dude, they show up at... I mean, this is... Okay, let's say it's speculative, but they go to the actual third-party physical toy store locations and talk to the designers.
Wow.
Okay, and exchange ideas with the designers of third parties.
Is that why there's some similar engineering that sometimes starts with third party and ends up with, you know, combiner wars. We understand.
I'm not saying anything, but
it's in our book, reading.
Right. But what I was going to say is if you remember in 2014, Takara said 2015 would be the year of the Decepticon masterpiece. Any of you guys remember that, Bill?
I remember that.
And this is what they were going to do. A new masterpiece Combaticon every other month. On the 10th month, they would have completed Bruticus, and on the 12th month, we were going to get an MP Galvatron. Just so you guys know, before the old MP designer, because he was salary, made every single G1 masterpiece already. He had a prototype for every character in the G1 line.
Are you talking about the first designer that did the first run? The first guy. Okay, not the guy that did the Datsun cars.
No.
Okay.
No. And that's the whole reason why it screwed up the year of the Decepticon, the Combaticons, why we didn't get a Galvatron in 2015 or a Masterpiece Combiner was because they were switching designers. If you notice, Bumblebee was supposed to come out in September or August, but it didn't come out till February the next year.
That's true. Yeah, I remember that.
Trax got pushed way back. It was all because of the designer and them wanting to go with new. They already had designs that were great. They made a Trypticon for the War for Cybertron game, but they said, "Oh, it's going to cost us too much," so they never released it.
Wow.
And it was sick.
The design for the game was sick.
I saw the prototype for the T-Rex, the dinosaur, and it was
Oh my god,
it was so amazing. But they never made. They just said, "I'll scrap it."
This is the depressing portion of our podcast.
Exactly. I apologize. Well, if we could take a little moment here while you digest your drink and maybe take another one. All right. Remember, folks, for all your G.I. Joe needs, BigBoyCollectibles.com.
BigBoyCollectibles.com.
For all your G.I. Joe era and modern era needs.
Back to Chris.
Word.
Back to the regularly scheduled program.
So Chris, how long have you been into Transformers? What were you into when you first got into Transformers? Was there something else, or have you always been a strictly Transformer guy from the get-go?
Oh no, yeah. Whenever my computer gets a little more juice in it, I try to collect something from everything that I like anime-wise. You know, Ninja Scroll. Fist of the North Star, Ghost in the Shell, and like Gremlins, not just anime. You know, I love the NECA Gremlin figures. I mean, of course, I'm a Transformer collector, so most everything in here is Transformers. But like, I had to have at least one Hot Toys figure, so I got a Predator. You know, that kind of stuff.
I see behind you on the left hand side there something Alan would love. Defining moments, Hogan.
I've got that one too.
Yeah. Hogan sucks. Hogan sucks.
Yeah, don't listen to him. Don't listen to him. His medication hasn't kicked in yet.
I look at Hulk Hogan as being two different people. There's the personality that I grew up with, he's fine. Then there's the guy in real life. I don't even want to comment because I'm not allowed
Chris,
to judge.
Hulk Hogan himself says he's two different people because when he was on the witness stand, he said the character Hulk Hogan has a 10-foot cock. Terry Bollea, though, has a normal-sized cock.
I thought it was a 10-foot cock.
Yeah, he actually said this on the witness stand.
I would
he
not
believes
wish
it, too.
I would not wish that on my worst enemy. You would step on it? I mean, oh.
No, imagine getting around counters.
Or if you're handcuffed and being frisked by a cop and he asks you, what's this, as he's grabbing your cock.
That's my surfboard.
That video is funny.
There
I've seen
video
that on YouTube.
On the internet, and he
I've
goes,
seen that.
That's my penis.
What's your...
The cop's like, oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Oh, he's got a gun! He's got a gun!
He goes, oh.
Nope, that's my penis.
Layers. All right, this has gone off the side then.
Yes, this
that's
is
my fault.
Okay,
I was told that's okay.
Speaking of Hulk Hogan, shout out to the NWO. You know, anniversary time, 20 years.
20th anniversary is yesterday, man.
If they're not paying for that shout out, we don't need to hear it.
speaking of wrestling, what's his, that really big wrestler is going to be fighting Mark Hunt tonight?
Oh. Brock Lesnar.
Brock Lesnar.
Andre the Giant. Oh, wrong one.
Yeah,
you know, there's a lot of people posting right now that the best outcome of tonight's fight is that no matter who wins, Randy Orton jumps in with an RKO out of nowhere. Because he's facing Brock Lesnar at SummerSlam. So that would be the best way to end the evening.
Totally. But the problem is I'm big into MMA, and as far as most of us are concerned, he won't last more than a minute against Mark Hunt. Mark Hunt is
beast.
He hit so he broke Stefan Struve's jaw with like a left hook and broke it in like three places. The guy is not even human.
He's a beast.
Yeah. He's a beast. And Brock Lesnar is a beast. Don't get me wrong. If Brock Lesnar bull rushed him with all his power and took him down, that would be dangerous. But Mark Hunt is just too skilled. He is too
What's
strong.
His name? What's his name again?
Mark Hunt.
He's from Australia.
Wait, what's his name again?
He's funny.
Mark Hunt.
No, say it quickly.
Mark Hunt.
Mark Hunt.
Oh!
He wants more con.
Dirty dog. Dirty dog.
Hey, he leaves the non-corporate shit to us while he sits over there with the clean mouth.
Oh, I protected myself earlier. Okay. I have my bubble around me. I'm fine. It's you guys.
You made us say more cunt.
Yeah, and I keep telling Hasbro, please don't get mad at me. Don't get mad at me. I'm trying to keep as much to myself as I can. You know what I mean? Like,
So now that you've taken a sabbatical, are you planning on continuing in any kind of capacity? You're working yourself in, or you're good?
The only way that I'll come back in is if my brother comes back in. He's the man. He's the one. Like, all I did was bring designers, you know, real talent, and sell product to the stores. Make the deals. Like, when it comes to in the factory, in Hong Kong, busting ass, packaging stuff, doing a triple quality check, you know, in his office when he's supposed to be working, like, I have to be with him. If me and him can come back in, I'll do it again.
That's fair.
Yeah, I'll do it again. And if you want to know the deals that I would cut with customizers for their own third parties, I don't mind discussing that. That's real simple. Basically, it just came down to whatever the price of the product was, you would get 50% of our markup. And we never marked up much. Like I said, if an item was $10, we wanted 15 for it.
All right.
You weren't being greedy about it, which is, you know.
Never. Never. And it was a good thing because the stores went ahead and were greedy for us.
Right. And again, that's a big issue. Is, you know, it's all about the money.
How does that? You know what? That's a good question. How does it? I'm sorry, Bill. But that's a good. That's a question that I have. If the store marks up the item, the third party item, let's say made by Dr. Wu, do they get to keep all of the markup? And you guys already been paid because you got paid for when you were contracted.
We just want what we want. We're not trying. Like, some stores will even hold product back, wait till it gets popular, remember, and then bring it out at three times the price. We don't do. Matter of fact, in third party world, many companies don't even have their own product. They sell so many of their run that even their own personal KFC blaster, he's done sold it to somebody.
And wow. So
if he wants to do a review of it or something, he's got to borrow it from somebody who owns it.
You know what? The KFC blaster reminds me of a pet peeve that I have with third party. And you can clarify this.
What paint?
The paint. Don't get me wrong. I love metallic paint. All right? But a lot of... So I'm not one of... I don't have a problem with the paint. I know that it was chipping and whatever, but I don't play with mine that much. I pose them, put them on a shelf, and just look at it, okay? But a lot of people would have rather had the all red one. And what really grinds my gears is that the first run, it can't do a leg split, but in the second non-metallic paint, they gave them flaps so that they can split apart the legs. Is this because they hate me and they want me to buy the same figure twice, or is this because this is what they have to do to be able to produce something else? And what decision I mean, not that you know particularly about that product, but how do you come up with the decision of which one you're going to go with first, and then if that's successful, roll out with what other people what people have been asking for instead?
Well, see, that's what I don't. Go, Bill, please. You haven't been talking at all. You talk, please.
Well, I'm the least skilled in Transformers here, but I would assume that the reason is that exactly what you said. People complained about it, and hey, now we got what you want.
Yes and no, because getting better articulation should be something that we see. That's the problem. We expect that out of the gate. Out of the gate, we want the definitive version. This thing about not getting a definitive version and then say, oh, for the same price or maybe a little bit more, you can get the definitive version. And you're like, I just got this one, and this one's better.
Listen, I'll break it down like this, though. You think about how many people buy the same rehashed Snake Eyes figure over and over
But Bill, we're talking about...
And you think Transformer fans... are any different? They probably are way more spendy than G.I. Joe fans.
It's a little bit different. We're talking about a Snake Eyes that's $15 retail versus a $150 toy. And I've got, for the rest of the year on my pre-order, I've got five or six more 150-plus figures coming out. All right? There's a certain... So that's what's frustrating about it.
I don't
You're both 100% correct. He's right. Transformer people like to have every single version, but Pedro, you're right, because the item is $150. I can't buy multiples of a $150 item when there's a million other things I have to buy out there, you know, that kind of deal. But you're both right in both instances.
So why do you think is that they – how do they make that decision? How do they come across?
Well, this is what I dislike is – okay, there were four people running things. We're out. You got these good guys, and the two other guys are business people. And so the only thing that we are like, okay, we'll make money on a repaint. That's great. But they will be like, let's purposely make the head screwed up, and let's leave this out, and then we'll sell an upgrade kit later and make even more money. That's dirty. That is dirty to me. But that's not the designers. That's not the designers. That's the middleman, and that's the businessman, the greedy son of a gun.
Yes, because if you bought Ferro Rex, Well, let's put it this way. If you bought the KO oversized Ferro Rex, it came with the lion head on the torso. All right? But these wings here, this extra mane, is fixed. Okay? But after releasing that oversized Ferro Rex a few months later, they came out with an upgrade kit where you can now have swivel hands on the figures, and now you can hide the mane. Awesome. All right? Sneaky, sneaky. And they know, like Bill, they know I'll buy that. All right? Yeah. This doesn't bother me as much because I, you know what? If I want to, I'll stay with the original. But right. I do have a problem with an added articulation point on a figure on a second run.
Yeah.
That to me is a structural no-no.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay, so. But let me ask you this. I completely agree, and I don't like, obviously, I wasn't able to sell Transformers because I couldn't make money off of even a stranger, right? But let me ask you this. Like, what do you think what Fans Toys did when they first came out with Slag? And I love Fans Toys. Everybody loves Fans Toys.
Oh,
but
yeah.
Their first Slag was loose as could be. My arms, boom. They do not even stay up. But their second run was vastly improved. Is this an issue for you? Like, are you upset?
I'll be honest with you. I don't get as upset. First of all, my Slag doesn't have a problem. But I don't play with it a lot. For me, it is, especially because it's third party, I consider it a risk. Okay, and I consider now.
Everybody, you're right. Everybody should take it into consideration.
But what I do like to hear that when they go on a second run, then they fix it. To me, that's legitimate. You're not.
And then the second figure doesn't have the problem.
Yeah, and the second figure doesn't have a problem. I'm okay with that. Okay, especially if they admit they had a problem. And what a lot of third party companies do, not all of them, but a lot, they provide you with extra parts to fix it. Or to upgrade it.
Let's just bring up Hasbro Takara would never do in 100 billion years.
Never, ever.
They gave you two left hands, and you complained about it, and they make millions and millions of dollars, and you complained about it to them, they'd say return it to the store.
Yep.
And yet a third-party company that takes huge losses on every single part they have to replace, they're expected to... I mean, I'm not... I don't want to be mean to, you know, because I know how terrible it is to get a figure with two left arms.
Yeah.
But I just don't understand how people are so like, you better give me a new one or your company is trashed. You're right. It will be trashed if it gets a bad name. It's only made 2,000 of that product. And I'm just saying, like, if
anybody... Yeah, the backlash... And the backlash online is brutal. For that stuff is brutal. I've seen that. But I had a couple of pieces that were broken, I had a piece that was broken, and a joint that when I tried to move it cracked on the Perfect Effect Devastate Combiner Wars Devastator upgrade kit.
Oh no!
That's right.
Perfect Effect are usually really great quality.
Yeah, they provided upgrades. And I had to do, and that's one of the good things about Big Bad Toy Store too. Big Bad Toy Store replaced the piece that was broken, and they gave me it was loose. Not that the piece came broken, but it had really loose fists.
I remember that.
And all I had to do was call Big Bad Toy Store, all right, and they had extra pieces to send back. That's happened to me a couple of other times too, that where I've gotten that customer service. So if you guys, third party, have something worked out with the retailers, all right, to be able to provide that service, especially early on, it's huge. First figure out of the gate, second figure out of the gate, you got to provide some kind of at least mea culpa online. You know, they have, you know, and try to figure out some way to help the customer. See that?
I understand, especially when you're paying three times as much as you would a normal figure or more.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. That's why I do have a problem if the figure is significantly improved, like engineering wise. Okay. Then I'm like, oh, that's not cool. But if we're talking that, you know, they had some issues with the first one, they try to fix it, but not like Perfect Effect. Actually, in their new editions of the upgrade armor for the CW Devastator, it says on there that it is the new improved hands. that I had. So you don't have to call it. You don't have to call Big Bad or Toys or TF Swords to get a new pair. Same thing with Fans Toys. I bought my Quake Wave. Or Quake Blast, the Fans Toys one. All right.
Quake Wave.
I bought that from Captured Prey. You know Captured Prey, and I think that's, I got to give the guy credit. He does all of that from his home.
Yeah.
He sells stuff from him that too. That cannot be easy. He mailed me not one but two times upgrades for that figure without me having to call him or anything. He sent me upgraded pieces, and like the one that allows you to turn the if you wanted to have the hose in turn it around the arm and have it in a G1 style.
Yeah.
And then he, after that, because the new ones were going to have transclearant hands and barrel, he sent me that too separately.
He's part of the crew that is part of the LA Collective.
Oh.
Captured Prey, Toy Arena, Toy Hell, all three of them
come
and set up displays. It's every other month at Kiraman's house in Long Beach. It's right across from the...
Alan! Oh, you missed out, Alan.
I know. There you go.
Alan used to live in... Where did you live?
Downtown Burbank.
Downtown Burbank, that's it.
He didn't even know that Simone was over there.
I had no idea.
Do you know where the Queen Mary gets parked?
Yes.
Wait a minute. Where are we going here? Wait a minute.
He lives across, on the beach right there, and that's where the meetups are.
It wasn't totally close to me, but yeah, I mean, within the area, so.
Yeah, but if you could have got taken an Uber there.
I could have said, very expensive Uber, but yes.
Totally worth it. Ah, okay, so that's, I love what the third party does. I'm really glad that you shed a lot of light here on a lot of these ins and outs, a lot of these details. I love getting information. I'm really big into comics ever since I was a kid. So I love to find out what happened behind the offices. Okay, how they put the stuff together, the relationships between the artists, writers, colorists, their editors, the managing editors, the head editors, and that's why I love that you shed a lot of light on how this stuff comes about, because it just seems crazy. It just seems like the wild, wild west.
It does, but like I said, whenever they would have those group meetings in the evening, that's very organized, And they would know, you're making a Devastator? I am too. Oh, we'll see who does better. And they wouldn't care.
Wow, there's another thing I like to ask. Now that you brought that up, it reminded me. Do they? It seems every once in a while, or a lot of times, where third-party companies, one right after the other, almost tripping over each other, releasing the same figure, but their version. It happened with Hound. It happened with Inferno. It happened with lots of others. And then, voila, we get we get news, and we get pictures of a prototype from Takara for a Masterpiece Edition.
Yeah.
Do you think there's is it possible that they might have some inside information and that's why they know to, boom, we got to release this now before they even announce it?
They've always had inside information on Hasbro. Hasbro's biggest problem, and Hasbro will forgive me for saying this, I'm sure, because they know it's true, is their own employees. Their own employees are the ones, they have the biggest mouths. They're the ones telling everybody everything, and that's how we can have upgrades for stuff before they even come out. We've got the upgrades ready because we've already had the test shot.
No, that's what I love. Perfect effect. As soon as Combiner Wars hit the shelves, my pre-order is ready to be sent home for my upgrade kit.
Exactly. You think Perfect Effect didn't have a little heads up from an Hasbro employee? I mean,
And let me tell you, Perfect Effect is another one of those upper echelon, top tier. Okay, from the get go, they have produced the stuff that I have from 2009, 2010 is still top quality. I love the Frenzy and Rumble, and their cassettes made into weapons. All right, they are still amazing.
For City Commander, the ones that were on City Commander, those are sick. Especially,
and I've got the Nemesis ones, the black ones. Those are just insane. All right, they and these upgrades kits that they're doing now are incredible.
Yeah, that Devastator kit was the first time I ever seen the perfect effect, and it looked awesome. Yeah,
their figures. Oh, and one of my. Oh, I don't have it with me. One of the best reflector out in the market, in my opinion, is their little 3-piece reflector. Okay, that came with tons of weapons. Okay, that you can actually.
Oh yeah, I love that one. Yeah, I had every version.
Yeah, I've got both versions.
BigBoyCollectibles.com. Check them out.
I stepped on my own wire. First of all, this is the original.
Yeah, I love that. Memories.
The PE-11. All right, and the colors on this are just gorgeous.
Yeah.
And this, and then this is, of course, I had to get the G1 colors. This kind of upgrade, I don't mind. First of all, this is a great toy. All right, it's got, we got an echo going on, do we?
That's what I was noticing too, yeah.
Anybody have their speakers going? Are your speakers, Chris, the speakers on your computer?
Am I supposed to turn my computer all the way down?
The speakers on the computer.
Oh, no, I can't hear you anymore.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now. Is this okay?
You can hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can hear you.
That's
okay.
And there's no feedback. Good. All right, so get back. Look at all those pieces that it comes with, okay? All those weapons. I mean, it's got a sheath. I mean, this little robot with a sheath for a knife that you could attach to them, a Gatling gun, and it's all the pieces necessary to transform it into an actual camera with a tripod. It's parts forming to a certain extent, but brilliant parts forming where it could hold all the parts when in camera mode. I'm in.
Oh yeah, and the thing, and all those parts go on the individual figures to make each one look a little different, and they've all got different main weapon to make them individuals, and their articulation is unbelievable.
For this size, these figures are about 2 inches tall, a little bit over 2 inches.
Yeah,
these things are precious.
Yeah, they are.
What scale are those? When you go scale wise, are they?
God, that's legends.
I would say no. Actually, I think maybe legends. Maybe legends. I would say maybe Chug. No, they're too short. I would say legends.
Oh wait. If you think about it, they're supposed to be smaller, so it would be Chug scale.
I think it works with Chug.
He's right. I'm wrong. I'm totally
and
wrong.
And it came out during the Chug days.
Exactly.
And Chug is the size to the regular size Transformers of the late 2000s.
Yeah.
Basically, Classics, Hank K, Universe, United, you're right, United, and Generations. And that's what Hasbro and Takara would call their lines.
Yeah.
All right. Now, Chris, is there anything that you'd like to add? Anything you would like us to know? Anything you'd like to share with us or the people out there? Give the people what they want.
Well, there's just a few opinion-type things I wanted to throw out there that I find a lot of collectors don't usually do.
Yeah, get on your soapbox. Go right ahead.
Okay. Yeah, soapbox, if you don't. Just real quick.
Take your time.
You and I were talking about this. If you're becoming overrun with boxes for your Transformers, if you're the type of person that displays their Transformers and then puts the boxes away and you're becoming overrun, definitely consider getting rid of boxes. And the ones that you absolutely cannot get rid of, use the bigger boxes and collapse the other boxes and then just take all the plastic inserts and put them in your attic or something. But don't allow your collection's boxes to take away from your life or from your display life. And then even more important than that is lighting. When you put lighting on your Transformers, please always use 5,000 Kelvin or higher.
5,000 Kelvin or higher.
That is your white light. You will, if you compare something less than 5,000, your normal warm light, yellow light, to if you take any figure and put it in front of the warm light and then put it in front of white light, you will notice far more details. The colors will be more true, and the figure will look altogether better. So if you're really wanting to get, if you're going to spend $130 on one figure and you're going to have a whole display full of $130 figures, don't ruin it by not having the proper lighting. And I'm not saying that there's a right or wrong, but what I am saying is if 5,000 Kelvin or more will give you true white light that will actually show the colors that the Transformer should be in and give you a full view of all the details and stuff, where it's literally you catch a third of the details under warm light.
I absolutely agree. It's one of those things that I've learned that, you know, the kind of soft white light bulbs that we use at home and that we always buy are garbage. The lighting, that yellow is terrible. Women usually don't like the super white light because it shows details.
That's the thing.
God forbid.
Exactly.
God forbid. Yes, the house looking real.
Attracted in a certain light but not in others.
Yes.
And Jerry's like, bad light.
Yes. Like, people who are faithful.
Using that, I like to sit in dim corners.
Well, if you need to sit in dim corners, I need to get my bat vision going because I need to be in pure dark.
No, but that is absolutely true. I saw you showed me earlier, I don't know if you have enough juice for it, that you have some nice DTOFs, the go-to collector case for any toy collector with really nice lights. Where did you get those kind of lights?
I do need to change those. Check this out. Those lights right there, you get 25 feet. You get the lights and the power adapter, everything you need for one DeTal for $25 off this guy on eBay. I can find this link.
Yes, we need that. I need that.
Yeah, and then you guys can post it if you like. Shattered glass junkions and then regular junkions.
Oh, wow.
Dragon Ball Z, you know.
Nice.
MMA, I have. All the fighters live in Vegas, so I meet them and I sign up.
I was going to ask you if you go to fights.
Oh, yeah. My friend was Gina Carano's coach and a few other champions' coaches, so I met a lot of them.
Oh, that's like Art Sky Batman, isn't it? That's the which one is that one?
This is the steampunk one, the first one.
Oh, yes, that one is one of the best ones, that steampunk Batman.
I loved it. I
got the 9-inch figure.
There's the cowboy one, right?
Oh, Voltron! And there's the cowboy one.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, you actually got your... Which is the one on the right? The big Voltron on the right? The tallest one?
That one is the one that my good friend made in Japan, designed himself. And you see that masterpiece by Toynami?
Yeah.
He's the designer for that as well.
Wow. And I love that. That's what I need to do with mine. Put it in a glass case because mine fell over. It was not pretty.
But, you know, everybody's mad at Made in Japan. If they knew the whole story, I think they would understand.
What about Made in Japan with the...
Like, he didn't get to finish a lot of orders, and we had to stop mass producing his items because the fandom was so mad at him for not finishing his orders. And
On what figure?
He was making upgrades for Junkions and that kind of stuff.
Oh, yes, 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 the Made in Japan Junkion upgrades. I'm not that into Junkions, so I didn't get those, but I remember now.
My first gift for helping third parties was that TFC Scrapper. That is probably my favorite Transformer I own.
Oh, wow. Those are test shots, right, or prototypes?
Prototypes and test shots. That Ultra Magnus is the prototype. And
wow.
That's the six shot is a hand painted prototype. And then test shot eye gear, Transformazing toys, unique toys. What's his name again? Razor? No, not Razor.
But Dive Bomb.
Dive Bomb. Got it.
But is that the TFC one, or is that the unique toys one?
Unique toys.
Unique toys.
Just so you guys know, my biggest, the thing I'm most proud of contributing to the Transformer world is I did the design for Shatterglass Devastator.
Nice.
But they cheaped out on the stickers, so I had to go through and put the red crosses on
them. I was just noticing that. That looks amazing.
Because he's a disaster relief vehicle, Red Cross vehicles. So, like, they need heavy machinery to take rubble away from buildings and that kind of stuff.
Yes, and to rebuild, you know, cement for the rebuild base. And is that what I think it is?
If you look at the head, that's a Warfer Cybertron Bumblebee face with the Classics Cliff Jumper. No, Classics Bumblebee face with the Warfer Cybertron head. You know how, like, you got the Fans Project Cliff Jumper kit?
Yes.
We couldn't afford it, so we found what we thought was the perfect Cliff Jumper head.
Wow, that's awesome. So how did you make that? Okay, so the face is Bumblebee.
Yeah.
And the helmet?
Is Warfer Cybertron Cliff Jumper.
Okay, I'm on that.
And then down here, you know, this, my friend Kevin from Newcastle always likes to mess with my displays, so he puts Hasbro stuff in my in my third-party displays. But that's just, you know, I have to redo these.
What do you think about the, what are your thoughts on the Deca Toys, Jet Fire?
Well, okay, I opened it here.
Oh, pizza. Costco pizza, too. Really, it's actually not bad. It's pretty good.
Costco pizza is actually amazing.
I opened it here, and from taking it from here to there, I lost a finger. So I have never touched it or transformed it since. I let my best friend who passed away, David Sloan, transform it because he's a professional. But
how do you get to be a professional?
Like, he was a customizer, Dvorak Prime, and when it comes to, like, building, making builds, he was one of the best in the world, is in my opinion.
So he's like a plastic whisper.
Exactly. I wish I would have thought about that when he was alive.
I thought that was you, Pedro.
That should be your new name. You should be the plastic whisperer.
You know what? It's not bad. I might trademark that, but I'm not as good as that guy. I have not touched my Deca Toys Jetfire. I will not transform him. I put him in a display case, and that's it. What Optimus Prime is that up there?
Ava.
Is that a green light for your Ava?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I'm going to get Pedro a napkin.
And another pair of underwear.
That trailer alone.
Oh, the trailer alone is, I mean, it was just $600 was just crazy. My God. That is very cool, man.
And then, of course, you got to have your G1s.
There you go. Oh, my God. I love my Metroplex.
Little city display.
Nice. Yeah,
this is the room.
Metroplex? What was that one, Pedro, that I like?
The
little fat.
You love Metroplex? Oh, the Metro Titan from the, I forgot what line, but he's right here. You'll know what this is, Chris. I forgot the name of the line. Made Toys, something toy.
I can't remember myself now.
Master Made.
It's coming out soon.
Oh, I can't wait for that one. I can't wait for the Scorponok.
Yep.
And was there another one, or those are the only two they've announced so far?
Well, except the Gong we have already, and I think that's it, though. Yeah, Omega Supreme and Scorponok coming up.
It's actually enough. Oh, my God, where's that? Oh, my God, that's a life-size.
I'm only showing you because it's 3.5 foot tall, and if you ever watched that Bobby Skullface, the second video he made,
yes.
We shot flaming arrows into his chest.
Wait, Bobby Skullface is out where you are?
No. He asked us because Tyler used to live out here.
And he
asked us to make like a Vegas thing. So they melted a Devastator in my like, here, I'll show you a piece that's left.
Jeez.
This is a piece that's left from the Devastator that was melted. But in the video, they show the Devastator on fire, And it was right out here that we did it.
I have the same fire pit. Get out of here.
that's where we melted his ass. I guess all of his here.
All right, we're doing that at the Tri-State. We're doing something like that at the Tri-State Viper Barbecue. Well, we just want to get someone to sell Tunnels toys. Wow. First of all, great. Awesome place, man. I love the arches. I love the arches for the hallways, but the toys, the Transformers and the toys is what I really like.
Check it out. The hallways got yellow light. And then
You can definitely tell.
Oh, yeah. And then, even at the end of the hallway, white light from the sun.
¿Cómo están?
But
mira, estoy en vivo.
Oh, yeah. There's a new button.
Oh, sorry. I thought I hit it.
No, you didn't.
No, I didn't. Oh, the mute. It's on the side.
Mute on Google.
What? Who? Did any of you guys get this?
Okay, you're the man. You're the man to ask. I want you to show that to Alan. I did not get the faceplate and briefcase that we were supposed to get before that. Who do I complain to? For Brainstorm, for the Fans Project Brainstorm.
Oh man.
I never got it. I changed addresses, and I got the one. I got the little core. I didn't get the briefcase and the faceplate, but I did get. But I did get this show to Alan. It's awesome.
When was this? Like 7 years ago?
No, a year ago.
That is freaking beautiful.
Oh, Alan, wait till you see what it is.
These are all stickers.
It's a panini style. Yep. Okay, Glacial Bots was a Fans Project G1-esque original combiner.
Wow.
That is very, very cool.
And it comes with all the stickers that you need.
It's very 80s.
And yes. Look how accurate they are to the actual Glacial Bots.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
It's funny because the designer of this, we talked about, we actually named him tonight. I won't say who it is, but he was one of the guys we talked about.
Wow.
He's very proud of this, and I think it's a wonderful G1 rehashing. It's very nostalgic.
It's very
like you in 1985, and
It's very unique. You needed to have become like a. It was like a membership fee with Fans Project Online about 2 years ago.
Yeah. Maybe four.
No.
No, you're probably right. I mean,
I don't remember, but I know it might have been 2 years, but I never got the faceplate and the suitcase for Brainstorm. So
yeah. Oh, if I were you, okay, who'd you buy it from? FP Core?
Yeah, I got it from the club. I was supposed to get it for free, but I had changed last August. I think is when they mailed them. I had changed my address. I had a PO box, but I got rid of it. And I went online before they were released. I said, "Oh, I better change it." I never received it. And I always receive my packages.
I would blow them up if I were you. But Fans Project Core, as you know, is not Fans Project. It's like, you know, it's like a guy that convinced them, "Let me sell your stuff and call myself FP Core." They're like, "Well, as long as you follow our rules to a T, fine."
Because they
make more money selling stuff through Core than they would through like a normal store.
It's actually kind of like Hasbro Toy Shop. Hasbro Toy Shop is not owned by Hasbro.
Exactly.
Okay. So I gotta find them. I gotta find them on Facebook. I just have been putting it off and I forget. And then
can you excuse me just for one moment? I'll be right back.
Sure.
I'm sorry. I'm terribly sorry.
Go right ahead. Go right ahead.
BigBoyCollectibles.com.
Yes, for all of your G.I. Joe needs, vehicles, figures, weapons.
BigBoyCollectibles.com.
Era, modern era.
BigBoyCollectibles.com.
I'm trying to convince a new sculpt, but I guess nobody wants it.
BigBoyCollectibles.com.
Their prices are insane.
Insane. Oh, and free shipping. And free shipping over $65. All right. Well, this has been quite an education.
Yeah.
But I love finding out little nuances about how things are done. This is like our own History Channel modern what's that show called? Modern.
Mythbusters.
No, not Mythbusters. The one where they show you how McDonald's cheeseburgers are made, or how steel is made today.
How it's made.
It's called metal or no, it's called modern something.
Oh,
modern marbles.
Thank you. I think that's it.
Oh, modern marbles. Okay, I'm also looking at Mythbusters though too, in a way.
No, he's not so much busting myths here. He's giving us, you know, he's giving us how they cut the potatoes and put it on the conveyor belt and how they spray them so that they don't go old. And then they freeze fry them, or they first freeze them, and then they flash fry them. But anyway, let's go back.
Where are you going?
Now I want potatoes.
Well, yeah, but what do they spray them with? Like ammonia or something really nasty that?
Look, if they're gonna allow cameras into their factories, they're not gonna tell you that.
Oh, you're right. You're absolutely correct. I'm one of those conspiracy theorists. I'm just like. I'm a conspiracy realist, not a theorist.
Okay, I like that.
I was a theorist in my 20s. I'm too old to be a theorist. I'm a realist now.
Yeah, I believe when it comes to conspiracy theories, if you're telling me about it, it's probably not real.
Right.
Okay? If I'm finding out about it, it's probably not real. All right? If I hear bubbles, it's probably not real.
What do you? If you hear bubbles, it's real.
No, that was actually a really good one. I got what he was talking about.
It took me a second because I was looking down. I heard it at the
time. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. But yeah, but you would believe somebody who came at you that actually had a law that and the number of the law and said, look, this is what the law says. And it actually says what the person's claiming it to say, then there's not much of a theory going on. That's more realism.
My favorite.
Breaking the law.
Judas Priest. No, Beavis in my head. Okay.
Breaking the law. Oh my God! Did you guys see the meme? There was a picture online of an old homeless guy with his T-shirt over his face.
Yes.
And it's basically Cornholio 20 years later.
It was perfect. All he was missing was PP for his bunghole.
But somebody, I think, quoted him saying,
"I got him." So perfect.
That was just too funny.
That is hilarious, dude. My God.
All right. Well, this has gone long enough, but I could actually go on forever.
I feel like we just started. I was just going to say, like, we got through the small beginning stuff. Let's go ahead and get crazy now.
Get crazy. Let's get crazy. Oh, wait a minute. I thought you were spent.
Crazy yet.
No. But I mean, no. If you're closing up, we can save it for another time, whatever you like.
I would like to save it for another time. Absolutely.
We could have a part two easily. We could make this a multi.
Part two, man. I could have this guy on every week.
Yeah.
Well, no.
We don't have to. No. I just meant you and I. Forget the broadcast. I'm just saying you and I. Right. We could talk Transformers forever.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I don't know if anybody might have questions like that listen to the podcast.
We pretty much covered.
Okay, good.
Some of them were named, so we do some editing.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I've got very thin skin.
and you're out in the desert? Are you crazy?
That's what makes it possible. You don't get hot.
It's a nice dry heat. It's dry heat without the humidity.
I'm not sweating right now, and it's like 100 plus. If you guys had it at 90, you guys would be like drip, drip, drip.
Dude, I'm sweating when it's 70 plus and humidity.
Forget that.
Even with a little breeze, I was outside working in the backyard, and we're talking about just thick humidity. It's 72, 73 degrees, but I'm sweating like a pig. Even though pigs don't sweat.
That's cold to me. Yes. Like, I would be freezing my butt off, but with the humidity, forget all that. But this is one thing I don't understand. Why do humans live in places where you got to spend an hour shoveling snow before you go to work, and then spend another 20 minutes letting your car warm up and scraping ice off of it every day?
Because you
why
know,
would you live somewhere like
you,
that?
You know why? You know all those products that take a while to get to you? We get them right here. We get them right, we get them right at the bay.
Oh,
we get everything right there.
They're coming into our ports, baby.
I get you. It's one of the scale things.
Trust me, there are a lot of other. There's some other perks. It's very expensive too, which is kind of like, yeah, I wonder why.
Oh my God.
But let me tell you, you don't get bored. Even if you don't, you don't get bored. Unless you want to, you do not get bored.
Well, that's a good thing. I live right up on the mountain, so I've got plenty of all of Red Rock to go run around and act.
Oh,
like
a wow, that's awesome. That's awesome.
And my house is like this spot for all the other Transformer collectors. So like,
I can see.
Everybody, you know, like throughout the week, people come by every day. That they hide their. You know, like, they'll make a purchase they don't want their wife to know about, and they'll leave all their Transformers here. I've got piles of Transformers from, like, 5 different people because they don't want their wives to see them. You know?
Oh, my God.
They've actually started sending them to my house so they don't take the risk of getting caught.
Okay, I think I got to go out. I think I have to go out to Las Vegas.
Come out. You can stay with me anytime, brother.
Now it's over. Now it's definite. Now
all three of you guys.
Now it's happening. Well,
yeah, meanwhile, Chris, I asked these guys to visit me for years in SoCal. Nothing.
SoCal, that's the greatest place on earth.
LA suburb, please. And I'll tell you one thing. His place doesn't have Costco pizza or all the plastic around you.
We just got an IKEA right down the street.
Yeah, IKEA? Oh, my God, you can walk home when you're detoff.
Pedro, I had Frank and Sons. You would have salivated over that place.
Honestly, Frank and Sons, that is the go to PopCon because you think you're going to find deals on shit. No, everything is overpriced. You go to Frank and Sons, it's literally like a swap meet with third-party Transformers.
Every Saturday and every Wednesday.
I don't want to hear this. I don't
want to you for a while to visit me, Pedro, to come to Frankenstein's. You would have.
Yeah, but you never sent me my airplane ticket.
Dude, Vegas is the cheapest places. You should come to Vegas and then drive out there because it's only 2.5 hours away. And
yeah,
Vegas,
pretty close.
They basically pay you to come out here because they want you to waste all your money at our casinos.
Okay, next summer, road trip. All right, Chris, we got to wrap this up, but it's been absolutely awesome.
Yes.
I am so glad to hear that you've got even more in the tank because we are definitely going back to this. Definitely. All right, I love third party. I'm a big time. I am a nostalgia collector from the 80s, but I love pieces of artwork.
Mm-hmm.
And this is artwork. To be able to display this. Okay, or upgrade kits for really bad Beavers Transformers.
I knocked that over whenever I was showing you around. All right.
Look at that chrome. Look at that chrome. But is there any last thing that you want to say? That you want to share?
If I may, I just want to give a shout out to LA Collective, to the Vegas Transformer crew. Tyler Lee, Jason Brand, Get It Right Robot, love that guy, and my brother, who I love very much in Hong Kong, Keith, and Dr. Wu, I hope I didn't say anything to upset you. He really is a shy guy, and when he hears all your guys' compliments, it makes him feel so good.
How does he know about our compliments?
Well, like, when I showed him the stuff on whenever I wrote on that page, and then he'll watch his podcast. Just like Fans Project, made sure to tell me they're going to be watching this podcast too. They said, you better not say anything.
Hey, Fans Project, I want some third-party Transformers from Fans Project.
Oh, we're going to spill the beans. Oh, we're going to spill the beans.
And start me off with my first one. Let's go.
Yeah. We're holding you captive. But and most of all, I want to thank the three of you.
Thank you.
Bill, we didn't get to talk a whole lot, and Alan, we didn't get to talk a whole lot, but I can tell you guys are great guys, more than honorable men. You are the G.I. Joe man. Alan is the third-party masterpiece man, it seems like. It's an honor to meet you both. I really appreciate it. I hope we get to know each other.
Yeah, look, I do most of the talking. But it's a person that goes with the territory. No, these are my brothers. These are my G.I. Joe and Transformer brothers.
Hey, Rob.
But we had a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun.
Definitely.
All right, and it's really good to know, and it's why I love it. I have jerks living around me, but on the other side of the country. All right, and in New Jersey, Bill. Are really cool, you know, bad men right there.
There you go. Boom,
all right, so this is Pedro.
This is Alan.
And this is Bill. Don't forget and to our website.
I'm Chris.
All right, don't forget our website, theplasticempire.com, on Facebook, everywhere. Don't forget
Plastic Empire.
Bigboycollectibles.com.
Instagram, The Plastic Empire. Twitter, _ Plastic Empire, _. And email for Skype and any inquiries is tpe@theplasticempire.com. Be sure to add us. You could always ask us questions during the show live. And thank you again.
And I'm available for parties at the Plastic in the Attic on Facebook.
Be sure to like and share everything. Our page shares are better than likes, people. And,
shares are better than likes.
And make
shares
sure to subscribe likes. To us on YouTube. Subscribe.
Subscribe. Peace.
Peace.
Peace. Peace and love, y'all.
Peace.
And Satan.
Oh.